Hello, good morning everyone from GNN. This is Rama Ellambali from GNN TV. In wake of recent arrests raids and deportations by USCIS in many cities across America, we at GNN wanted to talk to Prashanthi Reddy Garu about what is happening and any other potential universities that fall under this category and any other advisors that she may wanted to advise the students going forward. Hello, Prashanthi Reddy.
Hello. Thank you for having me on the show.
So, it is believed that there are a lot of students are impacted by this, and back home many parents are really worried about what is happening to their kids. And most importantly, it is believed that there are more universities that fall under this category. At this juncture, what do you suggest? If you could give more information on, shed some more information on, what's the next step, best course of action for the students at this point?
So, just to give you a brief intro on what's happening, for those who don't know, most of you know, but just in case you don't know, just a brief summary. As you know, Farmington University was a setup by ICE, so they set up the entire university to the sting operation, and it started in 2015, and they've been enrolling students since. And coincidentally, at that same time, a lot of independent universities had lost their accreditation, and as a result of which, a large population flocked to Farmington because the tuition fee was cheaper and they didn't see any issue with it. And as they joined, the tuition fee was taken from them, I-20s were issued, Seavis was updated, now Farmington was on the ICE website, so everybody thought it was fine and that it was accredited and that there are no issues. As they joined the university and a month passed, 2 months passed, and there were no classes being conducted. A few of the students asked what was happening. They said, we're conducting online classes, we're going to start now. And everything seemed to be fine. The setup and the responses that they were getting, reassuring them that, they were fine and classes are going to be started shortly, and they're ICE accredited, they're Seavis accredited and accredited by the Department of Education. So, it's like different segments of population reacted differently. Some of them got worried and tried to, some of them were able to transfer their Seavis to other universities, and they again had to pay the tuition fee for the other university after paying $20,000 a year. So only some of them could afford to do that. Some of them transferred to a H1. Others tried to contact the university, but they were not able to, so they couldn't transfer their Seavis. Because students are at the mercy of their universities. And if the university doesn't agree to transfer Seavis, they cannot. So they pretty much cannot change status, they cannot transfer to another university. They can change status, but they can't transfer to another university. And also the economic burden for them, paying another $20,000 to a different university after already paying here and not being able to get a refund. Some students were, it's a combination of things. Some students, maybe they were like, an ostrich buried their head in the sand. They were like that. And they were like, okay, if I don't see anything, nothing is wrong here, So it's a combination of things and desperation and these people not getting picked in the cap. They did their first master's, they did their OPT, they did their CPT. And they didn't get, they did their STEM OPT. They didn't get picked in the cap once, twice, third time. So the only way they could maintain status is by transferring to a different university and maintaining their F1. Otherwise they would have to leave after spending so much money. And we know a lot of these kids come from poor backgrounds, lower middle class backgrounds, where their parents are, in most situations, their parents are retired. They've taken loan to come to the US and to pay for the tuition fee. So this is the economic situation of these students. Then what has happened is suddenly, the week before last, all their services were terminated, and ICE declared that this was a university set up by them. And they rounded up about close to 150, I believe, 130 to 150 students all across the country, and they put them in detention centers. Some of them have been issued bond, many of them have not. So they cannot come out on bond until their court date comes in court, and then they can ask for bond before a judge. Okay. Now in New Jersey, the ground situation, since I've been actively involved here, yeah, in the sex, they were four people. So last week, on Monday, I went along with the New York Consul General, okay, to all the detention centers in New Jersey. One is in Elizabeth, and the other is in Essex. In Elizabeth, by that time, a few students had already been granted bond, so they were leaving or in the process of leaving. But I met nine students who were not granted bond, because the ICE officer later explained to me that perhaps when they were being initially processed, they should have been asked the question of, do you have any immediate relatives? Do you have any relatives, any friends who can act as surety? And maybe they said no out of fear that maybe their friend, family will also be affected. Or it could be that the ICE did not do their job and they did not ask that question, which is also possible. So as a result of which, they were not given bond. And I think the same thing happened across the different states, depending on the officer, how, you know, well he thoroughly he processed the application. So there were nine people we met there, and there were four people in Essex. Luckily in Essex, out of the four people, two people were granted bond, but they didn't know what the process was, so they were still in detention. And we were able to get them released the day after, or the next day after that. You know, contact their family and friends, tell them what the process is, give them the documents, etc. So this, then I was wondering what to do with these nine people who have not been given bond. And then I decided that the best course of action would be to contact the top, because if we just contact the ICE officers, they're going to, we know how it is, they'll just ignore us. And it was nine people. So I did some research on who the top person is in ICE in Newark. And, you know, so we, and then I spoke to the consulate and I said, look, this is the only way. We have to contact the top person in ICE and ask if they can do a bond redetermination, which is very unusual, but, you know, if you go through the right channels, I thought it might be possible. And luckily, we were able to get an appointment with the field office director, ICE, and the assistant director, ICE, the next day itself. And we went, they were kind enough to see us, we went and met them, they had a list of all the students. There was also one girl who was in York, who was transferred to Pennsylvania from New Jersey. We were able to meet with them, they agreed, and we told them that everybody's situation is the same. Everybody has been charged with the same offense. And they all have, you know, family members, friends, or, you know, able to give surety, and it's possible that they might have been afraid and they didn't, you know, answer the questions properly. Is it possible to get a bond redetermination? They agreed. They said, give us the documents. They wanted affidavits and letters from family members to show that they were not a flight risk, documents to show that they were not a flight risk. But they did tell us that we cannot, everybody cannot be left, but we can try and do it for some people. So from our part, with the help of Parmesh, actually the ATA president, because it was impossible for me to do all the paperwork and contact everyone. Because we had to do it by the next day. So by the next day, 2 o'clock, we had to give him all the documents for everyone. Because he said that once they go into court, and they may be docketed to go into court very quickly, and if once they go into court, then they no longer have jurisdiction. ICE doesn't have jurisdiction. So they will not be able to get a bond. So we luckily were able to get all the documents and submit it to him. He initially granted a few, about four applications. And then I spoke to him the next day and I basically, you know, pleaded with him to do a few more. And he agreed to do two more. So altogether we got about six or seven out, which is really unprecedented because they don't do it. And he told me the same, and I knew it, that he was going above and beyond and doing this because of the intervention of the consulate, because, you know, we went and asked him the right questions and pointed out the right things to him. And I pointed out the application specifically, and I said, look, this person has a sister, this person has a brother. This person has their parents here who are visiting from India. So we were able to get, that was the maximum we were able to get. Now the next step is they've all, the remaining people have been given, and this I'm talking about all over the country, the same thing is happening.
Mm-hmm.
There are some of them have been given, in New Jersey they've all been given court dates.
Okay.
For March 13th. Across the country some have been given, some are still waiting for their court dates. So now we can ask for a bail, just a bail hearing to go before the judge, and we can bring them out on a bail hearing with those same documents that they provided. It's much easier to get bail before a judge. With ICE, it's more difficult. Or we can wait for their first hearing date to come up. They can wait for their first hearing date. And they can ask for a bail hearing at the first date itself. Or they can ask for voluntary departure at the first date itself. So that if they want to leave, it's not drawn out for another year and a half. If you ask for, if you say you're not guilty, you plead not guilty, then it could take a year and a half before, or a year, depending on the state, 6 months, before the merits are actually heard. So the merits are heard on a date called a calendar hearing date. An individual hearing date, sorry. So at the individual hearing, the judge will ask what is your relief, and you're not guilty, show why you're not guilty, or if you're guilty, what relief do you have, so that you're not removed from the country. This could take a while, so it really depends on each individual case, whether they think there is some relief that they have, then maybe they can proceed with the individual hearing. If they think there's no relief, then maybe they can take voluntary departure and try to come back in. Now, the advantage of voluntary departure as opposed to being removed from the country is there's no 3 to 10 year bar, which means they can come back. But remember, there's this new thing now, the unlawful presence memo, which came out on August 9th.
Okay.
So as per the unlawful presence memo, if you've been out of status for more than 6 months before the date of the memo was published, then the date of the memo is the cutoff point. So from that date, they're going to count 6 months. And that has already passed. It's February 4th. It was last Monday. So some people left before that time, and some people could not, and some people didn't. So that memo could come into play, and it's possible that you could still face a bar of 3 to 10 years. So we have to wait and see how that plays out. But with reference to removal, there's no issue because you can ask for voluntary departure.
So there is a word that is making rounds everywhere. It's called entrapment. So entrapment, is it legal or illegal?
So entrapment is a defense in criminal law. And if it comes up to the level of entrapment, the judge has to agree that it's entrapment. Not every case is entrapment. Federal agents often do this in different scenarios with reference to drug smuggling, reference to solicitation. So it depends on what happened and what the facts are. If the government, the federal agent was so intimately involved in the process and kept coercing the person, kept trying to convince the person to do something, for example, they give an example in criminal law that one federal officer tried to buy drugs off another person, and he kept calling that person, and he kept going to that person's house and knocking on the door, and the person kept refusing to sell him drugs. And then finally he said, oh my, this is for my sick mother who's in a lot of pain and she needs, and then he sold him the drugs. So that is entrapment. That comes to the level of entrapment. So with reference to Farmington, we don't know what exactly the facts are, but they come to the level of almost coercion or misrepresentation on a great level. People, they kept calling the students and saying, come and enroll and we're fine and everything's fine. You know, it could come to a level of entrapment. And that is a possible defense in immigration law as well, just as it is in criminal law. That is a creative defense, but it can be used. Another defense to use is, I guess, reinstatement. Get an I-20 from another university, apply there, and ask for your CVS to be transferred, and it's called reinstatement of status, and that's possible by filing an I-539 application. Could take 4 to 6 months to be processed. USCIS has to agree to it, obviously. It is not a relief, it's a relief that is discretionary, so it may or may not be granted.
Okay.
Everyone is talking about this magic date, February 5th. How is it so important? And because we are already past February 5th, now what is the best course of action for the student who already didn't go back, I mean, didn't fly back to India? They are already here. How do they protect themselves? And what is your advice on that?
Depends on the student, really. A lot of students are just so fed up with the situation, they don't really want to come back. I've spoken to them, and we just don't want to leave. And we'll make our life elsewhere, you know, we don't have to, there are other places to go to. And unfortunately, this is what the policies are doing, you know, bright students. I mean, they're obviously an asset to the country. They did this because they were trying to maintain status, not because they were trying to go out of status. Right, so there are other, I think I should have other priorities, USCIS should have other priorities. They are more pressing priorities that they can use their time on, instead of trying to trap students to commit a crime and then arresting them. That's, you know, it's quite ridiculous if you ask me. I mean, it's different to find a university that's not following the regulations and then go after them, but to set up a university and go through all this, you know, and use their resources and try to entrap students really seems above and beyond to me. You know, it seems that they should be using their resources. As a taxpayer, I think they should be using their resources elsewhere. But with reference to what is the future for these students, it's very unclear with reference to the unlawful presence law. But if they have joined, for example, that university before April 9th, before the memo came out, then they're pretty much, that's where that February 5th or February 4th date comes into effect, because it's 6 months if you count it from August 9th. So that's what everyone is talking about, that magic date. So some people left earlier because they were, so now the question is, to what extent will they enforce it? Will they enforce it or not? Because there have been other memos that have been published, but they haven't enforced them. Like the unlawful presence memo with reference to H-1s. They said they would enforce it, but they have, then they sent out another memo saying that for now their priority is, you know, people who are out of status, people who file 485s or I-539s, which could be students. So we have to wait and see to what extent they'll enforce it. If they do, then they're pretty much barred from 3 to 10 years, depending on how long they've been out of status. 3 years, maybe, if it's just 6 months. If it's over a year, then it's going to be 10 years. Again, I would like to wait and watch and see whether they're going to make this into an issue. Maybe they will for the Farmington students, because they're trying to set an example for other people so that they don't, they're more careful as to universities they choose, they make, you know. So we have to wait and watch, but I think it's definitely a problem. The unlawful presence memo is definitely a problem for them.
The other thing is, there are a lot of volunteers that are working hard to help these students that are affected by this Farmington University episode. And many Telugu organizations jumped in to help the same. What do you think? Do you think that this is beyond all of us, and maybe Indian government should jump in, like Ministry of Affairs, and can do some help here? Or what do you suggest? And any comments on that?
So the embassy has been actively involved, and I believe New York Consulate, as you can see, has been actively, Consul General has been involved, and they have a jurisdiction over 11 other states. But they have to have the resources. Like here they had me as a resource, and that's why successful. So elsewhere also, but I can't travel to, you know, 11 other states and do the same thing. And also now the time is, you know, gone for that. Now the law will take its course. But with reference to your question about what can be done, right? That's what you're saying, what can be done moving forward.
Right.
I think the embassy has, and in conjunction with some of the senators and congressmen, about 4 congressmen have joined together in the New Jersey area, New York area, and written to DHS, asking for these students to be treated well, and to be aware that these students are a good asset to the US, and F1s and universities, and I guess they brought that into the attention that, you know, everybody is affected, students in general are affected. They would, you know, they tried to bring that out in their letter. that this asset has to be protected and universities have to be protected. And I think the embassy is actively involved, but once it goes to court, really it's out of the government's hand. This is a different, and the court doesn't listen to anyone. They follow what the law is. So now I think, other than the, they still have, the government still has the ability to change the laws and to maybe rescind the unlawful presence memo, and maybe to that effect there can be more lobbying and advocacy done. And I believe there have been some lawsuits filed by some universities joined together and filed a lawsuit against this unlawful presence memo. So if that is rescinded, then of course these students have no issue.
Okay.
So this is what needs to be done: advocacy, meet your local congressman. The Indian embassy has to meet with their counterparts in the U.S. government, and judiciary is a big help. So if the judiciary strikes down the memo, then it's done, and they've done that in the past with reference to so many memos that the present administration has. Published.
Day one CPT, yeah. Is it legal, illegal? Yes, no, yes, what is it?
Day one CPT is legal. If you're doing it on a master's degree. They've said very clearly that the regulation clearly says that you can get a semester one CPT or day one CPT if you're on your second master's, if you're doing a graduate degree, provided that the degree requires it, but you can justify it. Your education justifies it. But the issue here is what they're saying is there is a law which was always there that if you had one OPT and you did a master's and then you do another master's, that means the same level of education, you cannot get again OPT for 1 year. So that law, they are expanding it and interpreting it in a way where they're saying if you do second master's, because it's the same level of education, you cannot again get CPT. That's what they're saying. So the issue is not day one CPT. The issue is if you've done OPT for 12 months, can you again get 12 months or whatever of CPT?
Right.
And USCIS is interpreting it to mean that you cannot, and people are worried that they'll see more and more RFEs. In our practice, we haven't so far received any RFEs of that nature saying that you cannot get another 12 months of CPT. We have received RFEs which say that they've taken CPT, have they actually gone to school, shows that they attended physical school and physical classes, shows the tuition fee, the transcripts, We've received a lot of RFEs like that, and we've been receiving those for the last couple of years when we file a change of status from F1 to H1. And we've been successful in getting those approvals because the students were able to show everything that they were asked to show. They just want to make sure they're going to school and not just working. But let's see, wait and watch. Maybe this CAP season we'll see different types of RFEs which talk about day one CPT as well. But I have heard from other attorneys that they have received such RFEs which say that since you have 12 months on OPT, you're not allowed 12 months on CPT.
There is a rumor that Farmington University is just one of the many universities that were set up by ICE, and there are more to come. There are already more that were set up by them, so this is just a tip of the iceberg. So what is your comment?
I wouldn't be surprised by that, but it does take a lot of resources and time to set up a university. But my take on the situation is now you know this is not the first time this has happened. University of Northern New Jersey, Tri-Valley, there have been so many universities, University of Virginia, that have all been either setups from ICE, in the case of University of Northern New Jersey, it was a setup, or it's been where the university has not followed the regulation, and the students have just ignored that and continued with their, working or whatever. So how much more evidence do we need to know that this is not going to work and that they shouldn't be doing this? So, CPT is not, the way they are using the F1 status is to work now. You can't do that. F1 is meant to study and to do an internship after that.
Mm-hmm.
But if your main goal is to work and that's why you're taking F1 status, that's going to you're going to have an issue with that. USCIS is going to push back if you keep doing that. There are people, so many of them who haven't gotten in the cab, and they continue doing courses, continue for 3-4 years on F1 status, and continue to work. So that is obviously, then you are misusing what the F1 status is meant for. You're using the loopholes, you're using, so if you're doing that, then be aware that it'll come back and bite you, that USCIS is going to push back on this.
There are a few more names that are making rounds. One is Cumberland University, and the other one is Harrisburg University, that is allowing day one CBTs. If I am a student of one of these universities, what is your suggestion at this point?
You know, day one CPT by itself is not the issue. As I said, even Harvard offers day one CPT. You know, a lot of prestigious universities, state universities, legitimate universities offer day one CPT. But the issue is doing day one CPT and not having classes, or having classes once in 3 months, or having all online classes. These are the dangerous situations that you can get yourself into. So if you're in a situation like that, please get out of it. Either leave the country and come back, or file for a change of status, or file for a transfer school. A lot of students are thinking that, oh, okay, we'll do a PhD from Cumberland. And it's not going to be an issue, you know, because it's not the same level of education, it's a master's. But whatever you do, if you're not maintaining your F1 status, you're not going to classes, you're doing all online courses, you're going once in 6 months to class,
right,
find out what are the regulations and make sure that you are following those regulations. Because then next will be Cumberland, or next will be Harrisburg, or whatever, you know. So just be aware of what the law is. Remember that ignorance of the law is not an excuse. It's not a justification. You can't say, oh, I didn't know.
Anything that you wanted to share with the parents back home of all the students that were affected, and anything else that you wanted to share before we close this discussion for today? Thank you.
Right, so parents, again, be aware of what your kids are doing. Do some research. You know, at that age, you know, kids coming in feel that nothing can affect them, that they're immune from everything. Because that's the age when you're so young, you are full of confidence and you think that anything is possible. So I know often the parents are not involved in this process because they don't know. They don't know about the universities. They leave it to the kids to do the research. Those kids, I mean, they are listening to their peers and their friends. They're like, you know, they do whatever the other people are doing. It's like a sheep mentality. And this can affect you, especially with reference to immigration, if you don't do proper research. And you go for the cheapest university possible without looking into actually whether that university is following the regulations or not. So I think it's impossible to do your research. Make sure that, speak to an immigration attorney, read up, everything is online now. Everything, the entire F1 regulations are online. But I know sometimes it can be confusing to interpret those regulations. So important to speak to an attorney before you join a university and make sure that university is following all the regulations as to what they can do, how many classes they can have online, how many classes they're doing physically. Also in general, I think all these organizations have to have, and they do have, seminars, or, you know, maybe back in India before they even come here,
right,
seminars or FAQs on what do's and don'ts for students who are coming here. They get into trouble in so many ways, not just this one way. This is, immigration is one way. Because they feel that they don't realize that this country is different and people respect the laws much more in this country than they do maybe in India, unfortunately, because the consequences are greater here if you don't follow the rules. While you might be able to get away with it in India because of, you know, whatever your connections, and then, you know, you can get away with it. And they're more lenient with reference to many things. And those same things, they're not that lenient here. Even a small infringement of the law, they take it very seriously. So very important, follow the, you know, for example, if you get into a fight with someone, it's not like in India that they just break it up and everyone goes their separate ways. You could be charged with assault just for getting into a fight, even though you're an innocent party sometimes. And once you're charged with assault and you're arrested, the small infringement could cause trouble for you for the rest of your life. even though you're not convicted by a judge, because they'll ask you, have you ever been arrested? And then you have to explain everywhere, and every job that you take. You know, it follows you. If you get into trouble on the road, and you're driving, you know, you don't follow their regulations, or you drive with an expired license, I've seen that happen very often, because they don't have sanctity for the laws. They don't give importance to the laws. That's very important. You know, that is something that cannot be overlooked. I think these are, you know, the suggestions I have to the children coming here, that don't take things for granted. Don't think that you are, nothing can happen to you, that you're a superhuman. You know? Because it will happen, and it will happen very suddenly, and then there's nothing you can do about it.
Another question, actually, with all these things happening currently surrounding immigration, do you think that DHS and USCIS wanted to stop immigrant students coming into the country? Because it is always believed that America is a land of opportunity. Is still America a land of opportunity? Is it land of opportunity? What is your comments?
So we have to always remember that immigration is politics, right? And since they can't change the regulation each time, the USCIS simply changes the interpretation of the regulation and opens and closes the door, the gates, immigration gates. So, over the years, you've seen sometimes that that immigration gate is opened up, and sometimes you see that it is closed, or, you know, one gate is closed and the other one is open. So the flow of immigrants is always checked. Throughout history, if you see, there's always an ebb and flow of immigrants. So this is, I mean, that's what it is now. Every administration that comes in has a different priority, or they have a different vote base. And accordingly, they try and ebb and flow this process of immigration. So that's what it is right now. It's we're in an administration that is not very friendly towards nobody's friendly towards illegal immigration, but they are sometimes sympathetic depending on the situation. But legal immigration, there are governments that are more friendlier and less friendlier. So we are in an administration now where they have sent out memos in his first term of office itself talking about, be America, buy America, which was basically talking even about legal immigration and H-1Bs actually, he talked about specifically in the memo and the executive order. So that gives us an indication, and also the immigration attorneys and even people who have been through the process will know, based on the high amount of denials and RFEs, requests for further evidence, that they're trying to put a stop on it, and they're trying to decrease the flow of immigration. So yes, there's an ebb right now, and there's a constriction in the immigration process, but that keeps changing.
Thank you, Prashanthi Garu, for all your efforts and also for being there for the community all the time when needed, and also for taking time to talk to our GNN viewers, particularly in the weekend. Thank you again. Any final, maybe closing statement that you wanted to share with our audience?
It's for me, pretty much I've been doing all this pro bono work, meaning voluntary. I really have not charged anything for what work I've done so far, but it gives me great pleasure to do it. Because I feel that I'm using my education towards helping the community, and I, you know, we don't all often get the opportunity of doing that. So I think it's been my pleasure in being able to help the community so far, and hopefully, time permitting, I'll be able to do it going forward as well.
Thank you. Thank you all.